So I would like to thank everybody that you come here, and especially you for organization, because it was some efforts to collect people and to announce all this. And first of all, the word quantum-like. Quantum-like means not quantum physics. So we are not doing quantum physics for brain. But we are not against quantum physics in brain, because many people in neurophysiology, they are very critical in the use of quantum models of real brain functioning. So quantum-like is important, and this is use of methodology and mathematical formalism of quantum theory outside of physics, anywhere. It can be used in many, many fields of research. Of course, some physicists are not happy with this. As Masanao told, I organized conferences of quantum information and foundations, and I know many top-level quantum physicists, and they have very different opinion. In principle, for example, Anton Zeilinger, who is my good friend, he is not against this activity, but his main question, why quantum? He told, you want to use non-classical probability, non-classical information, why you really want to use quantum models? Because there exist many, many non-classical models of probability and generalizations of logic, and he told, why you think that brain use quantum logic, but not some other logic? Mm-hmm. So it's a good question, and we don't have answers. So more or less, we do this pragmatically, because quantum formalism is most well-developed, and it works very well for physics. Why not to take it and try to apply it? Other physicists are strongly against, and even few of my good friends told, don't take our beautiful and great quantum physics by your dirty hands. So because they told no relation between our electrons, photons, and so on, and these biological systems. So we shall see. And for me, there's even another pragmatic support of this research. Quantum theory is linear. And linear theory is very good for computations and information processing. So roughly speaking, what is quantum information nowadays? It's linear algebra. And do it with probabilistic interpretation. So if you now take some people, for example, young generation and who work in quantum information, they don't know physics at all. They use this calculus in Hilbert space, states and operators as observables. And if you try to speak with them about process of radiation and so on, they have no idea about this. So from this viewpoint, they are not so different from us. So they declare, I am quantum information expert, but he's just expert in linear algebra and do it with probability and information. So, and we were happy. And then maybe for engineers, everybody knows that in engineering, very often, very complicated non-linear model, you can approximate by linear model. Every engineer do this. They expand in Taylor expansion and use the first term, then the model is linear. So my viewpoint to quantum formalism is this, that this is maybe beyond, at least in life science, they are non-linear complicated processes, but quantum formalism describes linear approximation. It's against viewpoint of physicists, because in quantum physics they told quantum description is final description. There are no hidden variables there. So quantum mechanics is linear because nature is linear, not because we use linear approximation. But we not in quantum physics. We are trying to go beyond quantum physics. So there are many works in this direction, even monographs. So now it attracts attention of many people. If you write quantum-like in Google, it would be maybe 200,000 references or more. You see that there is no the book of Jerome Boussimier, but Jerome never cite me, so I strive to use the same strategy, not cite Jerome. Yeah, so it's symmetric reaction. And in particular, there was, as I told, very big research, start research in this direction in Tokyo University of Science. Maybe Satoshi 15 years ago, or even older. So there was attempt. there was attempt to combine quantum physics, genetics, molecular biology, and plant biology. But as I told, we spent a lot of time because it was multidisciplinary. And when we started to understand each other, the money were terminated and people, biologists continue to work in biology, physicists and physics. So in any event, we wrote the book of Asana, me and Oya and many others. So, yeah. So as I thought, it's not quantum brain, because we know that also Nobel Prize guy, Roger Penrose, since many, many years, he promoted idea that our brain, that consciousness and cognition processing is not on the level of neurons, but on the level, on quantum level of so-called microtubules, which are essentially smaller. And for neurons, we cannot, in quantum formalism, in quantum physics, the main problem is that neuron is big from the viewpoint of quantum physics, and it cannot be in superposition. The caveat is superposition, when few alternatives are combined in one state. And therefore, Penrose and Stuart Hameroff, another famous in this discipline, they try to go deeper to microtubules and tell that they can be entanglement of microtubules and so on. I was at many talks. There's still, if you are interested, I think even this year, it will be a conference. It called Towards Science of Consciousness in Tucson, in Colorado. And I was sitting with people who do neurophysiology. They were strongly critical. In some way, the activity of Penrose and Hameroff can be even problem for you when you go to some neurophysiologists who are experienced in this research. They can demonstrate you very negative reaction, because they struggled a lot with Penrose and Hameroff. Their argument that the brain is too hot to demonstrate real quantum effects, that scales of time and space are too big for quantum effects and so on. Penrose and Hameroff struggle with this. They reply, make some model calculation. So there's very long debate. So some people think that brain really quantum, and others are very critical because, for example, Penrose, he needs even quantum gravity to describe. For him, our act of consciousness is collapse of superposition of two masses. And some people joke that we don't know what is quantum gravity. We need to know what is consciousness. Therefore, we explain consciousness with quantum gravity. So it is, but maybe, what is our position? We are not supporting Penrose, but we are not against. If it will happen that really cognition is produced on the level deeper than neurons. Neurophysiologists, they thought, what we see is only neurons who communicate. But Penrose told, no, it's just shadow at what happened on deep quantum level. Okay, maybe this and maybe this, but we tell brain is black box, and everything which we know that is produced information and consume information by using non-classical calculus. And this more or less mathematics here is crucial, that when we see that probability is non-classical, we can think that something is different. Again, my colleagues, whom I did not cite, but we cooperate, for example, Jerome Boussimier, he always tried to show that models in cognition and decision-making, they are, when we describe them in quantum way, that it's he tried to demonstrate that classical description is impossible. Wrote even papers about this, that, for example, is described only by quantum Markov chain, but not by classical. My position is pragmatic and different. My position is, as I told, quantum description is linear, it's simple, but it can exist classical description, which is much more complicated. Now, again, because people very often sell mysteries of quantum physics, mysteries, people like quantum non-locality, and I try to be pragmatic and use this as instrument. And from the instrument viewpoint, why quantum calculus is better? Because they use complex numbers, and you know that if you are doing signal processing, there is not only amplitude, but also phase. and phase is additional parameter. And everybody who do engineering, you know that if you implement more phases, you can generate more complex phenomena. So for example, if you, not even phases, but parameters. So if you cannot generate something with two parameters, maybe you can describe this with 10 parameters. Of course, model would be more complex, but it will. My viewpoint, more or less this, that quantum formalism introduced new parameters, phases, but these parameters are not, as engineer very often play these parameters. There is global model which describe how these parameters are invented and how they are connected. When we do some calculations, we can do analytic calculations. So we not just as engineer very often make simulation and think, okay, I use these parameters and it get better result. But we use some general model, we can make analytical calculations. But my picture, the power of this is in these additional parameters, which go smoothly through whole theory. Now, where this data which coming to us and shows that maybe world of cognition is non-classical. This is well known before us, not we who, it's not that we came to people who do decision making and cognition and told, oh, please buy our formalism. They have very long problem. And this is related to probability fallacies and irrational behavior. So it's in decision making, it's going from very long time, more or less from the first work of von Neumann on expected utility theory. And this was very highly discussed by Kahneman, who got for this Nobel Prize in economics, and Tversky. Tversky is one of the most cited psychologists of all time. And they studied many, many models of decision making and even big experimental research. And they came to conclusion that there are always some problems when people try to use usual statistics, usual probability theory, and they came to pessimistic conclusion. So should we continue to rely to classical probability and always get inconsistencies and so on, or another solution, maybe we should abandon statistical and probabilistic methods at all and start to individual case study. So maybe it is not so bad. I was at a few conferences in social science and cognition where people told that, for example, in social science, maybe it's better to ask one person in details why he likes Trump, than ask 1 million people and collect statistics who likes him, who not. But at least for me and other people who came from natural science background, we have the accustomed to use statistics, to use probability. So we cannot follow Kahneman, so to use heuristics. We want to make probability, but maybe just another model of probability. So and here it's good place to compare with geometry. Before Lobachevsky and Gauss, the general picture was that there is only one geometry, Euclidean geometry. If you read Kant, Kant even justifies that people can use only Euclidean geometry. And after Lobachevsky and so on, we see that there are many, many geometries, and each physical problem is accommodated with its own geometry. So for example, these people are surprised that we have probability fallacies and so on when we use classical probability. And they, it's maybe just a question of model. If you try to use Euclidean geometry in special relativity theory, you will get problems because special relativity theory is accommodated with Lobachevsky geometry. So maybe we can try to use quantum probability. So they're the same ideology, Kolmogorov probability, classical quantum probability, which can be associated with name of von Neumann, is non-classical and so on. Of course, the question of Salinger is still here. Maybe not quantum. So maybe brain is much more non-classical than electron. So electrons described are very well by quantum, but not brains. Yeah. But maybe it's okay for brains even to be in quantum. So in two words, what is the difference between quantum and classical probability? Classical probability is calculus of measures. So to each event, we assign some number, so between zero and one. And the key point is additivity. То есть probability of A or B is the sum of probabilities. In mathematics, you use sigma additivity. So this should be valid for countably many events. But if you read the book of Kolmogorov, where he established axiomatics, he told us countable additivity is not real. It's just mathematics to get good integration. So finite additivity is more or less the key point of classical probability. Quantum probability. It's not calculus of probabilities. Behind each probability, there is a complex number, probability amplitude. And there is calculus of these numbers. And then we get probability by using Born rule. This is square of probability amplitudes. So, and therefore the rules are different. The rules are different. What we can get in quantum physics? In quantum physics, in quantum mathematics, I can tell, we can get violation of additivity. Violation of additivity. So we can have two disjoint events, but we can have such probability of A1 or AB is less than the sum or larger than the sum. Why? If you put here, instead of each of them, square of psi, then the square of sum is not the sum of squares. So, and then we get some additional term, which is called interference term. And this interference term we can observe in experiments. So if we collect data, what we do in decision making and so on, we have two events. They can be very different decisions. And we can collect this probability, frequency, this and this. And then we see that they are not equal. And then we can calculate this term. And then it is very easy to make model quantum where observables are given by Hermitian matrices. It's enough typically 2 by 2. So quantum is simple. My main message, quantum is very simple. So maybe when you teach even students who you try to attract to this field, that there is no all this, typically when people tell quantum, others became afraid. Quantum is simple. If you know linear algebra over complex numbers, so you do quantum physics, quantum information, yeah? So there is this additional interference term. Therefore, in some decisions, probability can be higher than from classical viewpoint or less. Even if you go to quantum computing, there is also a lot of mysteries around quantum computing and different ideas why quantum computer works better, beat classical computer. Typically, people point to entanglement. Entanglement is also important because we should consider compound systems. But from my viewpoint, I don't have a paper about this. The key point is here. Значит, quantum algorithms, Satoshi disagree, but it's a very big question, and there are many, but it's my private viewpoint, and majority of physicists would not agree. My private viewpoint, K is here, and by working with quantum algorithm, classical algorithm will give you this probability, you want to get with high probability this event, but classical algorithm will give you this probability, but if this cosinus is larger than zero, you can get essentially higher probability. Quantum computer work probabilistically, then we check its solution on classical computer, but high probability to get right result is here. We can discuss Satoshi. Satoshi is skeptical. Okay. So in any event, so maybe this is the key point of quantum computing. But of course, because this cosinus, you have image that you have usual waves, but these are not waves of signal. These are waves of probability. And physicists very often they have pictures that they in this space is propagating the wave of probability, whether it means, but it's not so bad mathematically. Now, all decision-making methodology is based on Bayesian inference, on conditional probabilities. And the basic formula is Bayes formula, how we define conditional probability in classical probability theory. And you immediately see where is the root of all this here. That when we define classical probability, there is A and B. And we know that in quantum physics, not always we can jointly measure, for example, position and momentum. So if you want to have for example, B is momentum and A is position, and we want to define this condition of probability. In classical formalism, we should determine event that particle has this momentum in this position, but it does not exist. So this formula does not work. Then it leads to violation of this formula, formula of total probability. So there is also additional interference term. So now if you try to make update which is non-classical, it would be non-classical Bayesian inference. So it is also one of the problems when we try to publish papers on decision-making quantum models, because in decision-making, Bayesian network, Bayesian inference is so dominating. If we meet some expert in this field, typically he writes that we can do everything, and it is very standard reaction. We do everything and we don't need any quantum. So, but there exists non-Bayesian inference. Some data much better this. And you can look also pragmatically to all this activity. So this is extension of usual probability inference procedure. Again, we recall the words of Zeilinger. You can develop not only quantum non-Bayesian inference. If you go to, for example, deep information theory, there were attempts to make some non-Bayesian inference methods pragmatically on simulation and so on, but which are not quantum. But quantum again gave great ideology. If operators commute, you still can use classical probability inference. If they do not commute, you should use quantum. So we are not against Bayesian inference. We try to reply these people, we are not against you, but why are you against us? Yeah. So then I tried to use some heuristics, why quantum models are so useful for humans and other biological system, processing of information. I think here is important context sensitivity. So if system is very stable to context change, it's my again heuristics. One can agree or disagree. If system is stable and don't react quickly to change in environment, we can describe it classically. But if system is context sensitive, then classical processing of information may be not useful because context will change. For example, what is superposition? Superposition are two ambiguities, this or this, but you don't want to resolve them because, no, for example, you are some girl, you like some girl, and you don't know whether you love her or not. Of course, you can produce measurements and put all efforts to resolve this superposition and get answer, I love her, or another answer, I don't love her. But you can process this superposition. So, for example, you can still study at university, do different things, but this superposition in your brain is why it's so good, because you can have many such uncertainties in your life. And if you try to resolve all these uncertainties, it needs a lot of time and it needs a lot of space. Because if, for example, you have n questions, and if you want to construct classical probability space, it will be 2 in the degree n. And quantum vector, it has dimension n, complex dimension n. So it is easier to process these vectors than big probability distributions. It's again heuristics, because maybe. So paradoxes. As I told, classical decision theory is suffered from many paradoxes. So maybe you can go to Wikipedia and study these paradoxes. These are very useful. So what was development of decision theory? It was expected utility theory. Then there were paradoxes of Ailes and Esberg. And then there was new decision models, also classical probabilistic new paradoxes. And recently I was a paper of Erev. He is also Nobel Prize in economics. And he counted 35 basic paradoxes of decision theory. So it is clear that something's wrong. But if you go deep in the structure of these paradoxes, it's always violation of additivity of probability. So you go to Wikipedia and you can find the classical formulation. It's typically tricky, one buy this and then sell this. But if you look deeper, you find this. So all these paradoxes are violation of law of additivity of probability. And you see from previous slides that you can resolve this very easily in quantum framework. So, and in our papers, we resolved all these paradoxes just by using quantum calculus. But again, we don't know, maybe this quantum calculus will suffer of its own paradoxes. So maybe somebody, and it would be even name for this paradox, it would be paradox of quantum decision theory. So because we have no guarantee that quantum decision theory really describe our brain. We just try, maybe brain is more complex. Now, what is very interesting, where we connected to rationality. So in classical decision making, rationality was based on Savage-Schulze-Singh principle. This is formal formulation, but in few words, the heuristic formulation is the following. For example, I am in the United States before elections, before previous elections, for example, it was, there were two candidates, Trump and Biden, and I want to buy a house and I make analysis. Okay, if Biden would be president, would I buy house? Yes, I need a house and I will buy. If Trump would be president, should I buy house? Yes, I buy house. Then rationally, you can buy house even before elections. Very often before elections, house is cheaper. But this is rationality. This is rationality from classical decision viewpoint. And Kahneman, in fact, became Nobel Prize guy just to show him that this rationality is very often violated in decision making, in business, in finances, everywhere. Generally, people follow this. Generally, people follow this. But very often, people don't buy house because of uncertainty. So uncertainty is not money, but uncertainty is also some reality. And quantum mechanics is perfect to encode uncertainty. So this is connection to this. Yeah, Tversky, Shafir, rationality, and you can check that this violation of this rationality is of Savage-Schulze principle is just appearance of interference term in the formula of total probability. So formula of total probability is equivalent to classical rationality, or formula of total probability is the key element in classical probability inference. So we can say if person do classical Bayesian inference, he is rational from classical viewpoint. If it's valid and do something different in his brain, he can be described quantumly. At least we can try to describe him quantumly. Yeah, a lot of data, even in game theory. So in game theory, in prisoner's dilemma, if you are rational, you typically, you should select Nash equilibrium. But in many, many situations, people do not select, people do not select Nash equilibrium. And then we can try to describe these games also with quantum formalism. And here we went quite deeply. So for example, we match data and even can predict data and so on. Are quantum agents irrational? So here is again my heuristic beyond this. From classical viewpoint, quantum decision makers are irrational. They violate classical probability inference. They are non-Bayesian decision makers. But why they violate? Here maybe we disagree with Masanao. We also had long discussions, but nevertheless, why they use non-classical information processing? My heuristic is the following. Quantum is linear, so it is easier and quicker. When people are overloaded by information, they have no time, when you should make decision quickly. If you have 2 days, 3 days, you can sit and make classical logical analysis of the problem. But if you do quantum decision making, you do this quickly. There is a book of Kahneman, which is called Thinking Fast and Slow. And he did not mention quantum-like, but if you try to identify, it look very much that slow decision thinking, slow thinking is classical analysis, but fast thinking is quantum analysis. And quantum thinking, it's again my heuristics, became more and more important in modern society because we are really overloaded by information. So information coming from social networks from everywhere. And very often we don't have such time to make decisions. For example, when we studied with Emmanuel Patos, we wrote a paper about Brexit. It was at Brexit time in Great Britain. And we saw that people, when they were for or against Brexit, they never had the integral picture. They have some small slices where they were. And what are these slices? We come into quantum logic, to quantum logic. Quantum logic is logic where events are described by orthonormal processors, by orthogonal projectors in Hilbert space. Event is orthonormal projector on some space. And again, what is heuristics beyond quantum logic? Heuristic is the following. This is weaker constraints on reasoning. For example, in quantum logics, it's violated axiom of distributivity. So distributivity of conjunction and disjunction. So in some way, if you quantum reasoner, you can come to conclusions which you cannot come classically, because classically you would be restricted. You cannot do this, you cannot do this. Quantum can come. But this is precisely these inconsistencies which found people who use classical logic. Because if you take this algebra, this called orthomodular lattice of projectors, this is can be sliced in small sub-Boolean algebras corresponding to compatible questions, And quantum reasoner, if he should have decision, he just select this slice and do decision here. But maybe it is contradiction in with other questions in another slice. So classical decision maker, he should unify everything in one huge Boolean algebra. Maybe it's even not always possible. So what is the quantum scheme for decision making if you go to mathematics? No, it is states, belief states or mental states are normalized complex vectors of Hilbert space. They define it up to phase vector. So it is not just a vector. Then we have questions. Questions are given by Hermitian matrices. Very often you can do everything with 2x2 Hermitian matrix, so symmetric. And then to find probability to get the answer X to some question when you have mental states psi at the beginning is given by Born rule. So psi projector on the eigen subspace corresponding linear algebra is eigenvector, is projector on eigen subspace, and you get this answer. And this is much is reality when you select data and so on and make a model where you present questions by operators, you can match data. And even what is interesting, what was done in Tokyo University of Science, not in human, but with molecular biology, we were able to even predict behavior of populations of E. coli bacteria. In decision making, it's not only important to find probability of some answer, because after this question, we can ask another question. And for us, it's important to know what happened with your mental state. If you reply something, your mental state is changing. And in the simplest case, later I will show that maybe you should do everything much more in much more difficult way. But in the simplest case, this is just projection. If psi is initial mental state, you ask question, you get answer X, then you project your vector and normalize, So, and it's also work when you ask questions one after another and can use sometimes this rule, sometimes more complicated. Yes, order effect. One of the things where this quantum probability is, and quantum information is so good, is the order effect. And its power was very, in fact, it's not intuitively, it's clear that it should be this order effect, that probability depends on the order of questions. But it was really highlighted when in United States was great opinion poll after this Monica Lewinsky affair, where people, 10 million Americans were asked, is Bill Clinton honest and trustworthy, or is Al Gore his concurrent honest and trustworthy? And of course, it was from this huge data, it was clear that probabilities are different. So if you are first tell that Clinton is good, and then the probability that Al Gore is good is different from probability if you tell that Clinton is bad. In classical probability, at least again straightforwardly, but of course you can also make classical model. So this our difference with the group of Jerome. Jerome told, look, this order effect shows that classical description is totally impossible. It's even quantum description is easier. So if we go just straightforwardly to classical probability, then probability, this is probability space, this is chance. So then observables are given by random variables, and probability is symmetric because right in this way or in this way is the same. So at least directly, we cannot violate symmetry of probability. In quantum, it's clear because if operators non-commute, we can violate. We can violate. And this was the main contribution of Jerome and his student Wang. So they modeled order effect with two operators. It's one question about Clinton and other Gore, and non-commutative operators, then probabilities are different if commutator is non-zero. And they match with data. So they went through maybe 50 social opinion polls and found that everywhere the description with quantum operators is good and classical is not. So this was this problem. But yeah, and how we define joint probability when operators do not commute? We use Bayes formula. So in classical probability, we can write either this as fraction of this or this, or use this conditional probability, which can be defined in quantum physics in which way. We make first measurement, update quantum state by projection, and then make second measurement in this projected state. So this is well defined in quantum physics. So we define joint probability for non-commutative operators in this way. Of course, it's not symmetric. It's not symmetric because of this. First update this or first update this give different results. So it is written in these projectors and they do not commute. So yeah, what was not so good with description? What was not so good with description by Kermitian operators of order effect? We published joint paper where we found that in fact, if we try to combine this order effect with other effects in psychology, then description by projection leads to contradiction. So it was a big problem that because for example, Jerome and other people who close it to cognitive science, they always try to use projections. And it's very nice to teach people. You have vectors, picture, and this is your mental state. You ask question, and you project it here. Unfortunately, it does not work. It's good illustration, but in fact, decision making is more complicated. So we found that if we try to combine order effect with another effect, which is called response replicability effect, then we cannot use usual projections and Hermitian operators. In two words, it looks like situation in cognition is much more complicated than in quantum physics. Because in quantum physics, we can proceed with Hermitian representation of observables by Hermitian operators quite long. If you are students and if you study just textbook, you are sure that all quantum observables are given by Hermitian operators and state update by projection. Of course, in more advanced books in quantum information, you find such things as quantum instruments and so on. So here we should use more complicated, in fact, we should use quantum instruments. And it's not surprising that at this time we started to think that maybe Zeilinger was right and quantum description is too simple for cognition. And here we can go deeper, even in physics. In fact, we are not in worse situations than physicists. Quantum mechanics was not derived with some heuristically clear principles. For example, if you go to relativity theory, you have very simple principle: constant velocity of light plus relativistic invariance. Quantum mechanics, there are no principles. Quantum mechanics was derived in which way? There was black body radiation data, and people tried to find some formalism. We are in the same situation. People still in quantum physics are not sure that it's really described. And it was possibility to develop more exotic models of probability and information. And here is another test, not interference, but so-called Sorkin inequality. And here situation is really amazing. Here's big difference between two-slit experiment when there is interference on two slits or three-slit experiment. For me, it was surprised. But physicists spent a lot of time, and the group in Innsbruck, and we also tried to, this based on so-called Sorkin inequality. We tested this Sorkin inequality, but we did not find this violation. So our, it was people from finance in Nice, in Nice in France, they collected a lot of data, but it looks that it's supporting to use quantum. So it seems that brain is not more exotic than electron, And watching this, what is this effect which disturb to use the projection type measurement? This is response replicability effect. Let us look to it. For example, we have the same question A. We ask you, no, for example, is Clinton good guy? You reply, yes, Clinton is good. Then human behavior is that I ask you immediately, is Clinton good guy? You repeat, yes, yes, Clinton is good guy. No, if he do things that I joke about him. So this is AA response replicability. And this is satisfied for projection measurement. So the model of Busemir and Wang satisfied this. But in this experiment, because P square is equal P. But in this experiment, when we looked for order effects, there are two questions. First question about Clinton, another question about Gore, and then let us ask again the question about Clinton. We expect again response replicability. I was asked, is Clinton good? Yes, Clinton is very good. Then I was asked about Gore. I tell, for example, Gore is bad. After this, I am again asked about Clinton. My consistent behavior should tell that Clinton is good. So I did not change in the moment my opinion about Clinton just by replying about Gore. So, and now if you want to have ABA and BAD response replicability, it is proved in our paper in PLOS One that it cannot be described by projections and Hermitian operators. So we should go to more complex description of measurement theory, which is called theory of generalized observables. Here people say such works as positive operator valued measures and quantum instruments. Yeah, so and here we have Masanao Azao, who is one of creators of this theory of quantum instruments. And during my visit to Nagoya, we in a few days understood this connection, and we wrote two papers in Entropy and Journal of Mathematical Psychology to describe combination of order effect and response replicability effect with quantum instruments. So more effects, more complex instruments you should have. So it looks like brain is very complex thing, which is not just described by projections. In only very simple effects is projection. So if you would like to go deeply in this quantum cognition, you should use really advanced quantum measurement theory, because people came to quantum instruments and positive operator valued measures only in 70s, 80s in physics. So maybe first 50 years they were fine with projections. It looks like in cognition, simplest effects generate already non-projection type updates. They're all non-Bayesian. So more or less, this formalism gives huge spectrum of non-Bayesian updates, not only projection, but other outs. And I think I'm more or less finished because there is also a block. Maybe I continue tomorrow about quantum instruments, and those who will not come tomorrow. Maybe I shall make just remark about Bell inequalities. Very often Bell inequalities are considered as very mystical and strange thing, but it's not the case. It's just about correlations. So you have two pairs of questions. If you go to cognition, question A1 and A2 and question B1 and B2. And we can ask jointly this and this, and so on, but we cannot ask jointly A1 and A2. And we can find such situations when the K-dot incompatible. Such in human life, we also have questions where you would not reply immediately for both two. You just don't want. You reply either to this or cannot. So you can calculate these correlations. Classical probability predict this bound. Non-classical models arbitrarily give this, but quantum give very special bound to square root of 2. These are calculations in Hilbert space. So quantum is not arbitrary non-classical. This is very important point. And then of course we can, in physics typically it's explained by spooky action at the distance and so on, but in cognition it's not easy to use this ideology because spooky action at the distance is parapsychology. So if we follow physical stream, we should think that they are parapsychological effects. We again, not against them. Okay, maybe they exist and so on, but we don't want this explanation. And we explain this violation as, two questions asked two persons. And the key point is the incompatibility. So that this and this can be asked jointly and this and this. And there are many, many experiments where this can be studied. And for those who are interested in this, I think maybe interesting this paper in Journal of Experimental Psychology. And maybe tomorrow I will say a few more words about this Bell inequality. Yeah, so thank you very much.
Thank you,
Vitaly.
Any questions? You have any?
No, that's fine. That's it. I'm just curious about your remark about quantum physics that no principles. Mm. I was curious about your remark that quantum physics was not developed in any principled way.
This is not my remarks. There exists a paper of Anton Salin here, which is called Searching for Foundational Principle of Physics. And he wrote this, that in quantum physics, there is no any heuristic principle which lead to this. How it was discovered? There was black body radiation, and there was the graph, which was not the same as predict classical physics, Maxwell equations. And all people tried to reproduce just this graph. Max Planck was working on this. And instead of integral, he wrote power series, discrete series. And the sum of series is different from integral. And this sum of the energy is discrete. So the K word was such, take energy discrete. And energy was discrete. And then he got this answer of quantum statistics. Some people joke that Max Planck could not integrate, just he was bad student, so, but I think it's joke. After this, they tried to find some formalism for this, and it was also very heuristic. Heisenberg, he just wrote some formulas, and then he even did not know about matrix calculus. He went to the door in another office where mathematicians, and he told, when we multiply matrices, we multiply this by this. They thought, look, guys, these are matrices. And after this, everything was developed. And this justified this Nobel Prize of last year, because there were no any, this prize was compared classical physics with quantum, in fact. And because there were no justification theoretical that quantum cannot be reduced to classical. And as I told in physics, they're still not sure that they could they found in quantum physics some effects which are not described by quantum formalism. And this is what related to this three slit experiment and Sorkin inequalities and so on. From this, it's good for us. So if they tell why you use this formalism, you can reply and why you use that it's work. We shall use it's argue it work. So if you found that it does not work,
I'm very interested in your talk about characterization of quantum probability within the more many various non-classical probability. So is this your point that depends on the linearity of the expectation? Is it right?
It's not an expectation, but a linearity of calculus of amplitudes. Because quantum probability is calculus not of probabilities, but complex amplitudes. And complex amplitudes are vectors. For example, or is sum. So this is this linearity. So, and for me, I have even such idea. I think it would be never maybe tested by neurophysiologists. The brain has somewhere machinery to operate with complex amplitudes. So, and even I have idea of why, because when we our visual system, it's based on some columns of neurons, which represent this space. My idea is maybe in ancient, very ancient time, people started to use this visual system to estimate probability. Then this is really calculus of vectors.
As you know well, I'm from the context of algebraic quantum field theory. The quantum probability can be axiomatized from one viewpoint. The pair of observable algebra and states states as a linear functional on
algebra. Yes.
So these axioms consist of the linearity and the positivity and the unity. So I think if I define the quantum probability as this framework, I think also you can derive the Sorkin's equality or something. So I think this what is the point of the linearity program? I think the only origin of linearity is that correct?
It's correct picture. In fact, you can use this is more or less what was activity in quantum logic also to consider these linear functionals on state algebra. This commentary saying Shevin and physics, they say big domain where people use similar to quantum model, but not precisely quantum. And it's also characterized by linearity. But for example, for physics is the problem that nobody knows about them. So only you, Masanao, and qualified people know. But for example, people who are coming to my conference, I can say real physicists, they have no idea about this, but maybe they were not used in physics. So physicists are pragmatic. If they can go without these models, they go. Why we came to quantum instruments? Just because we published this paper where we see that projections do not work. After this, I spoke with Masanao maybe year 2000, first time I visited Nagoya. He told me for quantum instruments, but I thought, oh, this is very strange mathematical guy. He is doing so complex computations for so simple things. You can make projections at the end of the story. But when we could not make projections, I remember, there is Masanao. And I kind of came again to him. And maybe if physicists need this, they will use this. But up to now, they are fine with projections. Thank you.
Another question. I like to have some.
Question.
You talk about the linearity and this inherent, and also the key talk about linearity from the point of view of the non-commutative probability theory. However, there are two kinds of different kinds of the linearity. And Sorkin's problem and your linearity mentioned is the linearity for superposition. And your and linearity is near to the mixtures. Mm-hmm. And those two are usually different kind of linearities. However, linear algebraic mm-hmm. approach is starting from the mixture linearity, you can making the GNS yes. construction of the algebra, which if the algebra is non-commutative, you can realize the Hilbert space representation with this interference effect of the this UR linear. Start with the mixture linearity with non-commutative algebra, reproduce the superposition linearity. Mm-hmm. It's a very interesting mathematical story. Mm-hmm. So I want to remark that.
Thank you.
Yeah. But I suspect that in physics nobody knows this story.
Yeah.
Even in physics, huge distance between people who are qualified in mathematics. Physicists use just surface, mm-hmm. surface or formalism. Yeah. And but of course there exist many deep things.
Thank you.
Okay.
Maybe cognition will stimulate development of physics, of quantum physics, because it's not so strange, but here we have these very deep problems from very beginning. So, and maybe we will come to some things which stimulate physicists. Yeah. So it would be not surprising. Yes.
Thank you very much. We'd like to listen to your continued story tomorrow. So thank you very much. And we'd like to thank Andre again.
Yeah, thank you.
Minutes break.
So now I stop recording.
Yeah.
11:20.
Stop recording.
Okay, let's break. And you have
Are you sure? Yes.